Well, good morning and welcome.
Good morning.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
We'll stand as we are to sing our first hymn, How Great Is Our God.
Sing a cappella. It's on the screen. It's a video. Done it for the rest of them, we're going to play.
Well, if not, we'll sing something that's familiar to us. Whatever that might be.
Sound again. Gloria, Gloria,
Gloria, Gloria, in excelsis Deo. At the Father's right hand, Lord, receive our prayer. For you alone are the Holy One, and you alone are Lord. Gloria, Gloria, in excelsis Deo. Gloria, Gloria, in excelsis Deo. Glory, Father and Son, glory, Holy Spirit. With you we lift our hands up high, we glorify your name.
So we pray for the children as they go out to the youth groups. Lord, we ask for you to be with our young ones this morning and with our youth group leaders as they teach and help them in their faith at such a young age, that they will be encouraged by it and remember it always. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. And today's comment. Father, our Saviour, look on this wounded world in pity and in power. Hold us fast to your promise. It says of peach. Promise of peach? I tell you what, today's not going so well, is it? God, our Saviour, look on this wounded world in pity and in power. Hold us fast to your promise of peace, won for us by your Son, our Saviour, Jesus Christ.
Amen.
Have our first reading, please. That should be okay.
Thank you.
New Testament reading is taken from Galatians chapter 6, reading verses 7 to 16. Do not be deceived. God cannot be mocked. A man reaps what he sows. Whoever sows to please the flesh, from the flesh will reap destruction. Whoever sows to please the Spirit, from the Spirit will reap eternal life. Let us not become weary in doing good, for at the proper time we will reap a harvest if we do not give up. Therefore, as we have opportunity, let us do good for all people, especially to those who belong to the family of believers. See what large letters I use as I write to you with my own hand. Those who want to impress people by means of the flesh are trying to compel you to be circumcised. The only reason they do this is to avoid being persecuted for the cross of Christ. Not even those who are circumcised keep the law, yet they want you to be circumcised, that they may boast about your circumcision in the flesh. May I never boast except in the cross of our Lord Jesus Christ, through which the world has been crucified to me and I to the world. Neither circumcision nor uncircumcision means anything. What counts is the new creation. Peace and mercy to all who follow this rule, to the Israel of God. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. Ready?
Thank you.
I'd like to remain standing. Hear the Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to St. Luke.
Glory to you, O Lord.
I suspect the reading set for today coming up on the screen will be missing some verses, as in the lectionary. I'm going to pop them back in again. I'm going to be a naughty reader, and I'm going to put the bit the lectionary misses out back in again. So here we go, starting from Luke chapter 10 and verse 1. After this, the Lord appointed 70 others and sent them on ahead of him in pairs to every town and place where he himself intended to go. He said to them, "The harvest is plentiful, but the labourers are few. Therefore ask the Lord of the harvest to send out labourers into his harvest. Go on your way. See, I am sending you out like lambs into the midst of wolves. Carry no purse, no bag, no sandals, and greet nobody on the road. Whatever house you enter, first say peace to this house. And if someone is there who shares in peace, your peace will rest on that person. But if not, it will return to you. Remain in the same house, eating and drinking whatever they provide, for the labourer deserves to be paid. Do not move about from house to house. Whenever you enter a town and its people welcome you, eat what is set before you, cure the sick who are there, and say to them, 'The kingdom of God has come near to you.' But whenever you enter a town and they do not welcome you, go out into its streets and say, 'Even the dust of your town that clings to our feet we wipe off in protest against you. Yet know this, the kingdom of God has come near. I tell you, on that day it will be more tolerable for Sodom than for that town. Woe to you, Chorazin! Woe to you, Bethsaida! For if the deeds of power done in you that have been done in Tyre and Sidon, they would have repented long ago, sitting in sackcloth and ashes. But at the judgment it will be more tolerable for Tyre and Sidon than for you. And you, Capernaum, will you be exalted to heaven? No, you will be brought down to Hades. Whoever listens to me, and to whoever listens to you, listens to me," this is Jesus speaking again, "and to whoever rejects me, you rejects me, and to whoever rejects me, rejects the one who sent me." The 70 returned with joy, saying, "Lord, in your name even the demons submit to us." And Jesus said to them, "I watched Satan fall from heaven like a bolt of lightning. See, I have given you authority to tread on snakes and on scorpions and over all the power of the enemy, and nothing will hurt you. Nevertheless, do not rejoice at this that the spirits submit to you, but rejoice that your names are written in heaven." This is the Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Christ.
Would you like to sit down? Being a bit naughty, but lectionary tends to do that. If you work your way through the lectionary, it's always the verses of judgment and the lectionary leaves out, but they are part of Holy Scripture, and they're uttered by Jesus, which is why I kind of kept them in. And I think today's reading has some real challenges for us. It certainly has some real challenges for me. I was trying to put a sermon together from these verses. And again, they have a note of judgment about them. There's some dispute among English translations as well. If you notice at the beginning about how many that Jesus sent out, was it 70? Was it 72? Don't know. I mean, they're a varying meaning. So in one sense, that's not important, but at least they're both even numbers, which we'll come on to. I believe that 70 is actually quite significant from the book of, Numbers anyway. Moses had 70 people to kind of serve him. I think maybe Luke's heart came back to that, which we just don't know, but let's not dwell on it. But it remains that Jesus did send and still does send people out. And that should concern each and every one of us. We learned last week in the Gospel reading, I think that was down at Denston, that Jesus sent out his disciples as messengers. Luke actually uses the word angeloi there, angels. You know, I think that's quite, I do actually like that, you know, the fact that we the disciples and us going ahead of Jesus are referred to as angels, we go out ahead of him. We're all apostles and we're all messengers if we're followers of Jesus. And that's both a great privilege and a great challenge. As I think we'll find as we ponder this reading together, we're all in the export business, as it's been said. The disciples were sent out in pairs, not necessarily because of any theological reason, but it actually makes practical sense. If you look at the very early Christian mission, we always see partnership wherever you look. Paul had Barnabas, then Silas, then John Mark, then Silvanus. The Christian communities were planted in Paul's wake, but one exception. There's one exception in Acts 17 when Paul went to Athens on his own, and for once he left no Christian community behind. We must resist individualism. It's the only time when Paul went out without a companion. It's the only time he left without leaving a Christian community, what you might want to call it, a church. And I say some of my most exciting missional experiences have certainly been in prayers. I remember once when the Billy Graham mission in Oxford, and I went down with a very, very close friend of mine called Jane. Probably the closest female friend I've ever had, without her being a girlfriend, who used to say to us, "Oh, come on, you teenagers." And you know, she's a sort of person, she knew what I was thinking before I thought it. And we went down the streets to give people leaflets to come to the Billy Graham crusade. And we had, as again, we'll look at this a little bit as we go on, we had a very mixed reception from one young lass called Alison, who was just more or less waiting for the gospel. And we went back to see her a second time and we led her to Christ and she became a Christian and became a very active Christian. A great delight for Jane and myself. There was another occasion where we went to a really posh block of flats. Shows you how mixed the ground is. And knocked on the door, this gentleman, about 6 foot tall, stood up there and handed him this invite, invited him to come and see Billy Graham. He could help with a paper like that. At the end, he speaks and just dropped it on the floor. "I am a member of the congregation of Christ Church Cathedral, Oxford. Now go away." I looked at Jane and she looked at him and I thought, well, there you go. As I say, it's one of my most exciting and interesting experiences of being in pairs. Jesus said, "The harvest is plentiful, but the labourers are few. Therefore ask the Lord of the harvest to send out labourers into his harvest." And of course the Lord of the harvest is God Almighty. Remember the parable of the wheat and the tares? The enemy sowed amongst the wheat. The field is the world, and the world is the Lord, and he's the Lord of the harvest, and always will be. We're caught up in that authority. Now we get to the bit that shows up the difference between then and now. Now, how do we feel about that verse that we just read? How do we feel about that verse? Is the harvest plentiful? Are the labourers few? It seems to me there are plenty of others who want to spread the good news, but the harvest is sparse and resistant and hard. But according to Jesus, we all are his presence in our community. In our reading today, there's no emphasis on where Jesus actually went after that. Next, when the wake of his followers, he went to prepare the way. But they were sent out and they went. For the 70, there were Jesus' presence wherever they went, whether Jesus followed or not. This is difficult for us, I guess. It is for me. Who am I to say about Jesus' presence to other people? it's both a tremendous responsibility and a tremendous privilege. Listen to this extraordinary passage from Paul in 2 Corinthians. He's back again, the typical Paul, waxing lyrical. But thanks be to God, who in Jesus Christ always leads us out in triumphal procession and through us spreads in every place the fragrance that comes from knowing him. That's quite a high calling. For we are the aroma of Christ to God among those who are being saved and among those who are perishing. See, Paul even puts the positive and the negative together. To one, a fragrance from death to death. To the other, a fragrance from life to life. Who is sufficient for these things? I echo those words of Paul. Who is sufficient for these things? For we are not peddlers of God's word like so many, but in Christ we speak of persons of sincerity, the persons sent from God and standing in his presence. Who is sufficient for these things? Darwin questioned and asked me. But it reinforces the claim of carrying Jesus' presence into everywhere and wherever we go. It might not be easy for us, but it's true all the same. Are we going to take Jesus at his word? I noticed about 20 years ago, it became a bit of a buzz phrase, and a saying became fashionable, and I think I know where it originated. I think it originated from a former Archbishop of Canterbury. We are urged the mission to find out what God is already doing and to join in. I beg to differ. I take issue with that. This passage seems to beg us to see a mission of going and being a new work of God and carrying that presence with us. I'm now asking myself seriously what that might look like among us. I've pondered that this week, and it hasn't crystallised enough for me to share much of that among us. I'm going to talk about that in a little bit, even if I don't run out of time. But the question still remains, of course, that is, what kind of mission does Jesus want us to engage in? What strikes me then again is the difference between then and now. Carrying a purse and a bag or sandals on the road, okay? There's a sense of dogged purpose here, and that's very good. Matthew's version of this particular reading asks them not to carry any extra bags and sandals and stuff like that. And eat whatever they put before you. I was kind of again struck by that this week. These are Jewish believers. Oh, somebody sticks a pork chop on your plate. What do you do then? You know, I've been in places where I haven't wanted to eat stuff that people put in front of me. I remember again going in my very early days as an undergraduate, going to my girlfriend's house, and her parents brought out the Stilton cheese. My diet up to that particular point had been very conservative. I wasn't sure. I actually kept my Stilton cheese an awful lot, but it really amused me the fact that I'd never had Stilton cheese before, and I had to always look on my lips and force it in. After a little while, I got used to it. But what we can glean from this is that the mission will often be costly and will mean courage and vulnerability. Jesus describes in colourful language that he's sending us, yes, us, like lambs among wolves. We often live the opposite, don't we? To have a wolf among the lambs. I think many of us may know what it feels like if you've ever had ridicule for the stance of your faith amongst your colleagues, people you work with, people you live with, your neighbours. I've certainly known that in terms of quite intense persecution. I could tell you some interesting stories about that. Some amazing stories, actually. Some of the worst persecutors I've ever eventually turn to faith, sometimes decades later. God doesn't give up. Is it Wesley's talked about the hound of heaven? Something kind of follows you around you, keeps nagging at you. Come to me. All you labour and seek rest. The challenge is continuing this passage. If we are God's people, you and I are indeed God's presence in our community. Then look at verses 8 and 9. When you enter a town and his people welcome you, eat what's set before you, cure the sick who are there, and say to them, the kingdom of God has come near to you. There's a lot in that verse. First, there's cure the sick. Just don't do it. There's no kind of stuff coming alongside it. And I'm really looking forward post-lockdown to having more healing services here, which we had before lockdown, where we can actually actually anoint people with healing oil. We're actually allowed to lay on hands of healing. And this has kind of started to build up a little bit of a momentum. There's a deanery-wide, we had our local healing advisor, Paul Howard, along to talk to a bunch of us from the deanery about establishing a healing hub within the deanery and kick-starting the healing ministry among us. I was always amused when I realised the diocese appointed a new healing advisor. I looked at Paul Howard, I thought, that's interesting, I'm running off. And I said, 30 years ago, when I was at home, my dad went up to Bedworth Church and had a new curate called Paul Howard. Was that you? He said, yeah, I was curate at Bedworth. So we knew each other a lot. And he was even involved in the healing ministry then. Good man. I'm looking forward to working with him. Expand what this might look like in the future. I think one of the things in my heart is to maybe sometime sit down and think about taking healing out there, not just in the church, but out there, maybe the central towns and look to what we do to be both of healing. Often it's more, and what word to use, satisfying, more missional. It's scary. It can be very scary, but doing it out there. I remember a few years ago, St. Elizabeth went off to a conference. It was run by New Wine, and about the gift of prophecy. But had, in the afternoon, so you can go and do various things. You can do a prophecy workshop. You can go off what they call treasure hunting, in which case you pray in church, you know, word of knowledge, you like to find the person that Lord wants to touch with the gospel. Crazy stuff. Or you can go out and do our healing on the streets, which I kind of opted for. And the church in Aston, all the Aston Villa reporters were streaming up towards the ground. I think they were playing Manchester United or Liverpool. Anyway, someone they were supposed to have lost to. And the guys were going past and were offering prayers for them. One chap turned around and looked at me and said, if you want to pray that we beat Manchester United, then you can pray for us. And I said, right. I said, Aston Villa 1, Man United. Aston Villa 3, Man United 1. If that happens, will you promise me you'll get down tonight by your bedside on your knees and pray to God and thank him? At least that will open up prayer to you. And they said that I got back home and I sat there with bated breath and I watched the classified football results. And it came back, the fourth one, the last number of three, Manchester United 1. And I thought, I hope you keep your end of the bargain, mate. After that little exchange. It's more in heaven than earth sometimes than you can imagine. Basically, about 10 days ago, we had somebody who's in our ministry team meeting, actually, Yvonne Arida, who had quite intense pains between her shoulder blades and in her back, and we prayed for her for healing. She said, by the time I got home, I was completely healed. It's completely gone. These things can and do happen. I realise I'm probably going to get with her after time. Where do we go next? Not only are we the presence of the kingdom in our community, which we certainly are, our family, our workplace, etc., but we're also so close to the Lord who's brought us. A phrase I love to use is, whoever listens to you listens to me. We're so closely identified with Jesus. And whoever rejects you rejects me. And whoever rejects me rejects the one who sent me. Jesus is the Father. Remember when Saul persecuted the church of God? Jesus said to Saul that Saul was persecuting Jesus. Saul was persecuting the church. The presence again. We are the body of Christ. We're only the product of Jesus sending out the 70. We all return very excited and with joy. It's a word that Luke uses often in his gospel. It's a word that Gary used earlier on just before we left the vestry. Came out. It's 11 times in Luke's Gospel more than in any other New Testament book. Okay, the disciples being sent to preach the good news. We hear that they were commissioned to heal the sick, but what grabbed their experience and their attention was that, Lord, in your name, even the demons submit to us. That's great, that's wonderful. It shows that Jesus' power over evil and all that comes from that kingdom of darkness. Jesus, it says here, has given us authority. And this is where I want to end. Jesus drags them and us back to a truth that should continually and always shape our lives. Jesus said to them, I watched Satan fall like a bolt of lightning from heaven. See, I have given you authority to tread on snakes and scorpions, and over all of the power of the enemy, and nothing will hurt you. Nevertheless, do not rejoice at this, but the spirits submit to you, but rejoice that your names are written in heaven. That last statement I find a constant encouragement. Luke uses what's called the perfect tense here. It's something that's done, it's a present reality. It's a completed action. Each of our names are, as it were, etched in the heavenly stone that nobody could ever remove. Praise God for that. Stand to declare our faith in God. We say together,
we believe in God the Father, from whom every family in heaven and on earth is made. We believe in God the Son, who lives in our hearts through faith and fills us with his love. We believe in God the Holy Spirit, who strengthens us with the power from on high. We believe in one God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen.
Time for a decision.
Let us bring our cares and concerns before the God who loves us. We pray for more workers to gather in the harvest of the kingdom, for our churches to be places of welcome and wholesome spiritual nurture, for a heavenly balance of tradition and exploration. Use us, Lord, in the building of your kingdom. We pray for our nation and the nations of the world, for upholding of godly principles and just laws, for reconciliation, peace and mutual cooperation. Use us, Lord, in the building of your kingdom. We pray for those among our families and friends who have no idea of the new life you offer. We pray for them to discover you so that they may share the joy of living in your love. And we pray for Samson School in Kenya. And we pray for all our local community and businesses. The situation in Afghanistan following the earthquake. We pray for Ukraine and Russia. For all those working for a diplomatic solution. And for all the refugees, especially those that have come to our area. We pray for the pupils and staff at First Steps Preschool, Dove, All Saints, Rycroft and JCB Academy, Albert's Own, Denston College. And we also keep in our prayers the residents of Abbey Road, who is affected by the fire. Use us, Lord. We pray for those suffering from leprosy and other skin disorders, or those disfigured by disease or accidents, for the lonely, the confused, and the outcast. And we pray for those who are sick in our village and our community. Pat Oakes, Victoria Dixon, Ken Lampton, Mary Brown, Nicola Von Davison family, Diane Brandrick Holt, June Goodwin, Dennis Lear, Farrah Hunter Coley, Pauline Duval, Tessa Pearson. Use us, Lord, in the building of your kingdom. We praise you, Lord, and give you thanks for the fullness of the new life you have given us in Christ. Give us renewed and filled with your Spirit. And we pray for those who mourn. Tony Allen, David Russell, Elsie Baker, Paul Lipsy. In the building of your kingdom, use us, Lord. And we also pray for the anniversary of the baptism of Corey Andrew and Corby Ray Rossack. Use us, Lord. Merciful Father, accept these prayers for the sake of your Son, our Saviour, Jesus Christ. Amen.
Stand if you're able as we share with one another. Let the peace of Christ rule in your hearts, and with gratitude in your hearts sing psalms, hymns, and spiritual songs to God. The peace of the Lord be always with you.
And also with you.
Let us offer one another a sign of Christ's peace. Peace, not peace. Definitely peace.
How deep the
healing, the healing a little bit earlier on, if and that's Christ's gift of healing from God the Father by the Spirit is for all of us. I mean, by all of us, I mean body, soul, and spirit, emotions, whatever that is. So please feel free, when you come forward for communion, to ask God for healing. There will be healing prayers. So before we start, a short, general prayer. Let's just pray together. God our Father, one of the main missions of the Church is to preach the Gospel, but also to heal the sick and deliver the oppressed. Father, we pray that by your Spirit this morning you would empower us to be able to access that healing power, your love, your passion, your grace and your mercy. And Father, we ask these things in the healer par excellence, his name, our Saviour, our precious Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. The Lord is here.
His Spirit is with us.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give thanks and praise.
It is right to praise you, Father of all creation. In your love you made us for yourself. When we turned away you did not reject us, but came to meet us in your Son.
You embraced us as your children, and welcomed us to sit and eat with you.
In Christ you shared our life, that we might live in him and he in us.
He opened his arms of love upon the cross, and made for all the perfect sacrifice for sin.
On the night he was betrayed, at supper with his friends, he took bread and gave it to you, and gave you thanks. He broke it and gave it to them, saying, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me."
Father, we do this in remembrance of him. His body is the bread of life.
At the end of supper, taking the cup of wine, he gave you thanks and said, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood, the new covenant, which is shed for you for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in remembrance of me."
Father, we do this in remembrance of him. His blood is shed for all.
As you proclaim his death and celebrate his rising in glory, send your Holy Spirit that this bread and this wine may be to us the body of your dear Son.
As we eat and drink these holy gifts, make us one in Christ our risen Lord.
With your whole church throughout the world, we offer you this sacrifice of praise and lift our voice to join the eternal song of heaven.
Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest.
Saviour taught us, so we pray. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. We break this bread to share in the body of Christ.
Though we are many, we are one body, because we all share in one bread.
Lamb of God, you take away the sin of the world, have mercy on us.
Lamb of God, you take away the sin of the world, have mercy on us. Lamb of God, you take away the sin of the world, grant us peace.
Draw near with faith. Receive the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ, which was given for you. May it preserve your body and soul to everlasting life. Take and eat in remembrance that Christ died for you, and feed on him in your hearts, by faith with thanksgiving. Thank you.
throughout all generations, forever and ever.
Beyond our imagining, and whose power we cannot comprehend, show us your glory as far as we can grasp it, and shield us from knowing more than we can bear, until we may look upon you without fear, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Study continues here at 7:30 till 9 p.m. every Wednesday evening. This time we're looking at Paul's letters. That was the choice of the group. So come along and have a listen. You can just sit and listen or join in if you wish. That's here at 7:30. Liz is doing a quiet day. Well, that's a nice interactive host there, isn't it? So 23rd of July, from 10 a.m. till 4 p.m. and there's a slight cost to it, which is £5, and it's thinking about creativity and prayer. There's a sign-up sheet. Did you bring the sign-up sheet, Sarah? Did you bring the sign-up sheets for the event? Right, there will be a sign-up sheet, so we'll get a piece of paper and put it at the back, and if you are interested in signing up, then do put your name down there. There is something on the news sheet about it as well, so there's information there about how you can book and what it's all about.
Sorry Gary, I'll go get the notes because I've got a bit
of okay, yeah, that's fine, no problem. So you'll have to remind me, Mondays and Thursdays? Tuesdays and Thursdays, Little Angels, toddler group here. So if you know anyone that has little ones who struggle to find something to do with them, then there's always the group here. And I've been to a few of them and they're very good. They even entertain me. The children entertain me, not the adults, of course. Crafty group continues to meet Mondays 1 till 3. What's the theme? Is there a theme? We're looking at Susan. Little donkeys. Little donkeys for the donkey sanctuary. Oh, that sounds interesting. Okay, so if you're interested in seeing what that's about, you can come along and join in the craft, or you can just sit and have a cup of tea and a chat. I also sometimes do that as well. My craft skills aren't very good, but they can. Men's shed, Ian, do you want to wear men's shed?
Men's shed is running nicely. We're still renovating the garden bench. Come along Wednesdays, 10 o'clock, till about 12:30, 1 o'clock. Come and enjoy yourselves. Have a cup of tea. You don't have to do anything if you don't want to. Come for a chat and a cup of tea.
Same as the crafty group if you're at a loose end, and ideally if you're a man, because it's men's shed. And I'm sorry if there's any women who have lots of woodworking skills and lots of talent. but there we go. Please do come along to that if you're able. Okay, we continue to feed the poor here via the food bank, so if there is anything you wish to donate for us to take to the food bank, you're more than welcome to leave it at my house or at Liz's house just around the corner. If you'd like to donate for worship, you can follow the link on the website. Youth group? Make a suggestion to do something different with the dog show next year. Terry's got the list of the signing in list at the back, so you can go and sign in for Liz's quiet day. But the dog show, so I've got some suggestions, so I'll let you know who that person was, Susan, and we'll add that person to the list for next year to do something different. You can simply do a pumpkin sausage. Okay, that's all I'm going to say on that. Right, I have the Banns of Marriage to read. So, I published the Banns of Marriage between Jason James Kennedy and Rebecca Lee Alcott. This is for the first time of asking. If any of you know any reasons in law why these persons may not be married to each other, you are to declare it now. Rose to parish. Good, I'm always saying I don't know what to do if somebody says yes. And if there's no other notices, I would like for birthdays. You know it's Neil's birthday, but we've sung happy birthday to Neil yesterday. Any other birthdays or anniversaries today? Coming up this week? No? There we go. Okay, so can we have the two church wardens, please? It's a big sign there from Susan. Of the bishop. They discharge their duties as our law and custom assigned to them. They are to be foremost in their parish, representing the laity, and in cooperating with the incumbent, they are to use their best endeavours, both by their own personal example and by their teaching, to encourage their parishioners the practice of true religion and to promote true unity and peace among them. Do you, who have been admitted by the Archdeacon to the office of church warden in this parish, confirm before this congregation your promise to serve God gladly and willingly in this way?
I do, and I ask God to help me faithfully and diligently to perform the duties of the office of church warden for the year ahead.
And I do, and I ask God to help me faithfully and diligently to perform the duties of the office of church warden for the year ahead. Heavenly Father,
we thank you for calling us
to this office and duty in the life of this congregation and parish.
Help
us to remember your word of grace in us, and by your Holy Spirit, empower us to serve you and one another in what is in the name of Jesus Christ,
our Lord.
Amen.
God, who has called you to his work of church warden, give you also the strength and the enthusiasm to do it well. The glory and honour of Almighty God, in the name of Jesus Christ, and in the power of his Holy Spirit, may you serve selflessly for the well-being of all in this parish, and may God's blessing be with you in all that you do for him. Amen. There should be, this is coming to the congregation. So, Almighty God, for whom the salvation of this whole world gives to all his people many gifts and ministries, stir up in you, the congregation, all the gifts of his grace, to strengthen each of you to your ministry. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, be with you and remain with you always. Amen. So Ian, if you just go and advance the slide, and then we'll come back up at the end. Okay? You've got to come back up at the end, Susan, I know what you like. I think we have our final hymn. Here I am, Lord. I am I, the Lord, see in the scaffold.
I'm
peace to love and serve the Lord.
In the name of Christ.